synced so we can get out. So I'm here representing Rocha Canada. I work there as a conservation research biologist. And I'm just going to talk about some of the work we've been doing monitoring and conserving birds in the Little Campbell River watershed. So just to give a little context to the place where we work and what we're doing, many of you may not be familiar with Rocha. So Rocha is a faith-based environmental, international environmental conservation organization. It was started in Portugal in the early 80s, hence the Portuguese name, Rocha, which means the rock. And we are based in 20 different countries. Here in Canada, we have three main centers, in Ontario, in Manitoba, and then Brooksdale Environmental Center, which is in South Surrey here in BC. We have three main program areas. So we do conservation science, environmental education, and sustainable agriculture. We also host retreats and workshops, and we have a residential internship program as well. We take a watershed approach to conservation. So pretty much all of our work happens within the Little Campbell River or Tatalu watershed. The Little Campbell is a 30 kilometer long river which starts at its headwaters in South Langley and empties into Boundary Bay just on Semiamu First Nations land just north of the border. And our goal is to see thriving ecosystems and communities within this watershed, and we start accomplishing that goal by monitoring the species and habitats that are found there, and then we use that information to inform restoration work and conservation research. We prioritize species at risk, so these are just a few of the species that we've been working on. There are many more in the watershed, but these are the red-legged frog, the western toad, the Oregon forest snail, the painted turtle, Salish sucker, and barn swallows, the only bird on the list right now. So just in the rest of the talk, I'll be briefly mentioning four projects that we're currently working on with relevance to bird conservation. So the first is our barn swallow nest monitoring program. Second, our weekly bird walks. And then the last two are more indirectly related to birds but have significant implications for habitat. So those are riparian restoration and water quality monitoring. So I'll just jump right into our barn swallow project, which is what I have been mostly involved with. So many of you probably know that barn swallows, along with other swallows and aerial insectivores, have been globally declining. In Canada, they've declined by 80% since the 1970s, and they are federally listed as threatened under SARA. Primary reasons for declines are habitat loss and insect declines, as well as climate change and competition with non-native species, such as house sparrows and starlings. So Rocha started monitoring barn swallow nest success in 2014 with the primary purpose of just getting a sense for how they're doing locally and also educating landowners as to their status and trying to get people on the ground involved with their protection. So we started with 7 active sites that we knew had barn swallow nests, and that number has gradually increased over the years. So the past 2 years, we've been monitoring 16 sites. Most of those are on private farms and have between 1 and 3 nests per site. This barn on the bottom here was our most productive site. It had about anywhere from 10 to 20 active nests each year, but unfortunately it was lost to a fire in 2019. Luckily, it was during the non-breeding season, but we lost a lot of our active nests through that. So nest monitoring basically looks like peering inside the nests and counting the eggs and chicks, and then we estimate laying and hatching and fledging dates. We are trying to increase our citizen science component of the project. So we provide training and equipment to landowners who are interested and able to monitor their own nests. So this past year, we had 8 landowners who were monitoring nests for us and sending us their data. And many of those, this was their 3rd year in a row, and some have been doing it for much longer than that. And I think that this is a really important part of the project, just because it gets people really involved in conservation on their properties. And it also helps us to collect a lot more data than we otherwise would. So we're hoping to expand this component of the project. So as we continue with this, we want to build up a long-term data set. So we want to especially continue engaging landowners through citizen science. We want to partner with other scientists and contribute our data to larger projects. And we also want to explore more avenues for enhancing habitat locally for barn swallows. We don't want to just monitor their declines. We want to be doing something practical on the ground that can help them. So we're exploring the use of these artificial nest structures. This is a photo of a nest structure in Ontario that has been successfully used to by nesting barn swallows. So we're in discussion with a biologist who's based in the Columbia Valley, who's been testing out some of these structures, and we're hoping to maybe replicate those in the future at Brooksdale, maybe in some other areas as well. So moving on from barn swallows, I'll just briefly mention we do lead weekly bird walks. These are open to the public. They rotate among five different sites in the watershed, which you can see kind of on the map here. And they've been ongoing since 2004, so we've amassed a pretty valuable long-term data set since we do the same route each week or each time we visit a site. And they're led by expert birders, and all the data goes into eBird, so it's available. And then just touching on a little bit of what we're doing with restoration, one of our priorities at Arasha is to restore stream habitat. We've recently partnered with Farmland Advantage, which provides incentives to farmers to protect riparian zones. So we receive funding to connect with the landowners, many of whom we already have pre-existing relationships with. And then a program advisor comes and does an assessment on the property, and then we implement any restoration work that has been recommended. And the farmers get financially compensated for this. So we do restoration in a lot of different ways, but this is just one of our recent partnerships that we're really excited about. And that kind of links into our water quality work in Boundary Bay. So we've been working with a variety of stakeholders to try to narrow down where contamination is coming from that's going into the bay. And this is a kind of a food security issue as well. So many of you may know that the shellfish harvest has been closed in Boundary Bay since the 1970s. And traditionally, the Semiahmoo First Nations people relied on shellfish harvest in the long tidal flats. But they're currently unable to do that, and there's no federal mandate to improve water quality levels to levels that would allow for reopening of the shellfish harvest. And the main contaminant that we're focusing on here is fecal coliforms, which is a bacteria that's found inside the guts of warm-blooded animals. And it's been found that the Little Campbell River watershed is actually the main source of contamination coming into the bay. And sources are varied, but they include pet waste, stormwater runoff, failed septic systems, and livestock. And it's a very complex problem because there are so many different jurisdictions and responsible parties involved. So at Arasha, we are working to revitalize a transboundary working group called Shared Waters Alliance. Basically to bring all these stakeholders together and kind of standing alongside Semiahmoo First Nation to try to work together to accomplish the vision of a healthy Boundary Bay and ultimately reopening of the shellfish harvest. And this has implications for human communities as well as all the wildlife, including the birds that depend on the bay. So our main role at Arasha is to coordinate biannual roundtable working group meetings, as well as leading a water quality monitoring program to try to narrow down where that contamination is really coming from. So this is a map of all the sampling sites that we have been monitoring since September 2020, so just over a year now. One of the things we're focusing on right now is based on the data that we've been getting in from our water quality monitoring, trying to sample with more frequency some of those sites that we've been finding to be more contaminated, and also trying to increase the number of sampling sites, both upstream in Langley, and also in the marine environment around White Rock. And then we also work to restore habitat, forest habitat around streams, the tributaries of the Little Campbell, to try to improve native biodiversity and also to try to filter that runoff before it reaches the streams and flows into the bay. So that was a whirlwind kind of overview of a lot of our different projects. I'm happy to answer questions about any of them, or feel free to get in touch with me. I know it's late, so if you have questions and want to just email me, that would be great. I'd love to hear from you.